Presenter is Aitor Erce Dominguez, staff economist at the Spanish Central Bank and associate professor of economics at Universidad Autónoma de Madrid. Aitor has numerous publications in leading journals in finance economics, dealing with various aspects of global capital flows and particularly sovereign debt restructuring, so very topical issues. He's currently working on several projects that compare sovereign debt crises across time and across regions, particularly across the global north, global south frontier. His presentation will focus on the private end of the debate, after Martin's, by analyzing the responsibility of cross-border financing crisis.
Okay, so I mean, I'm going to be talking about what I think that there has been the role of cross-border banks in the spread of the global crisis and in the generation of the situation we have in Europe now. And I will try to give a few ideas about, I mean, like policy options and what I think that we are doing and if I think that it's wrong or what, or right. So motivation, I don't think that we need much, yeah? But I mean, after 5 years, after like a massive fiscal impulse, after deciding that fiscal impulse had to be removed from the economy. I mean, we have ended up with a very nasty situation in Europe where Europe is sort of broken into two pieces, yeah? So there is a core that is supposedly like really strong and wealthy, and there is a periphery where, I mean, we have loads of debts and we are needing massive support these days, yeah? So in terms of like policies, after trying so many different monetary policies, fiscal support, we have come to this point where, I mean, like, we finally agreed once more that monetary union with the fiscal union doesn't seem to work. So as a first step towards there, we have been talking about the possibility of setting up a banking union. Yeah? So far, I'm gonna say a bit more of this later on. I mean, the idea is that we are gonna have like this kind of like a systemic institutions monitoring that is gonna only be looking at like systemically important financial institutions, and it's gonna, I mean, it's gonna be the ECB who's gonna take the lead in this, and supposedly there's gonna be common resolution, a common safety net. But I mean, after all, I mean, like all these policy options that we are like thinking of and deploying, they always have like a balanced management of cross-border banks at the core of the policies. So in this paper, what I try to do is like give my view on what has been the role of cross-border banks into the crisis and how this can teach us about the kind of like a policy that maybe we need. So in a nutshell, just in case that I mean I don't get to the end because I have a lot of material. So cross-border banks, I mean we are gonna see it, no? But I mean, like with the euro, there was like this boom in like financial integration. So like cross-border positions between European banks exploded. Yeah? Then as the crisis unfolded, like these positions were reduced massively and really, really fast. I mean, this in part was done easily thanks to the fact that the euro system has a special way in which central banks are related and in which central banks can provide liquidity to the banks. Yeah? So this was good in the sense that it is a smooth the adjustment that we had to do. But I had a wrong side of it, that a lot of those private liabilities up there, they ended up in the public purse. Yeah? So this is what created this perverse fiscal financial link that we are living in nowadays. Yeah? So then in terms of policy, you know, I will explain that I think that all this setup is a clear example of an externality. Yeah, and being an externality, a banking union may be able to limit the effect of the externality, but there is no way that it's going to eliminate the externality per se. And I will argue that for that, maybe what we need is some sort of Pigouvian tax or some way of making like cross-border banks internalizing the potential cost that they generate. Okay. So I'm going to begin with a bit of evidence from past crises in emerging economies. Past three crises defined as financial crises that ended up into a fiscal mess. Yeah? Then I will talk briefly about the euro area. I'm going to tell the story of the crisis in two steps. One is the banking crisis that is beginning in 2007. I say it's finishing in 2010. And then we have the euro area sovereign debt crisis. And along this story of the crisis, I'm going to be showing you pieces of evidence that I think that make enough for me to explain you why I think that cross-border banks are generating an externality on governments in the euro area. Yeah? I will also talk a little bit about moral hazard and about policy options. Okay, so I mean, I have a paper with a colleague at Bank of Spain, Irina Valteanu, where we look at, I mean, we have like 40 years of financial and crisis and sovereign debt crisis, and what we do is like, we look at them thinking that sometimes financial crises end up in a fiscal mess, but some other times fiscal crises end up in a financial mess. Yeah? That's Greece, for instance. Yeah? So in that paper, what we do is like, we look at all these crises that usually people have been looking at in isolation, or maybe they have been looking at them in combination, but without addressing the direction. And we try to get to understand, I mean, like, what's going on? I mean, what are the stylized facts and how they help us thinking? Yeah? So yes, for today, I mean, there is one lesson. Yeah? And I like to link this idea to, because Macaulay and Post, we were talking about them before, I don't know if you know them, eh? But these guys are proposing nowadays that, I mean, to the extent that fiscal policy can, monetary policy can support fiscal policy, it should be doing it. It's this helicopter money idea, yeah? So, I mean, when you look at countries not so strong as the US, what you get to see is that in the face of large foreign currency liabilities, there is no way that the central bank can address the balance sheet recession by printing money. The only way that the authorities can help here is that they are able to find somewhere the foreign currency that is missing. Yeah? So, I mean, how I read this in euro area terms. Given the super tough stance at some points by the ECB, from the point of view of the authorities of the periphery, euro liabilities from the banks or the residents are quasi foreign currency liabilities. So that there is very little that the combination of fiscal and monetary policy can do there. Then, the crisis as a prelude. So as I just said, there were like huge capital flows between European countries with the onset of the euro. So in this graph, the bigger line on the top, those are all the assets that the euro periphery has in the entire world. The line on the bottom, the dotted line on the bottom, that's all the liabilities that the periphery has with the rest of the world, right? Now, the black line that you see, that okay, this black line that is going down here, this is simply the net foreign asset position of the periphery with the core of the euro area. So, I mean, I didn't do it, but if you calculate what's the difference between the gross assets in the world, the gross liabilities in the world, the difference is exactly the imbalance within the euro area. This is to say that the European periphery has an imbalance not with the world in general, but only with the core of the periphery, right? Now, yeah, so since the beginning of the euro, there were all these large flows from the core and to the periphery, and then, like, most of the imbalances of the euro area periphery is with the core, but with the core banks, because what I showed before is data for the entire economy. This is data only for the banks. And this is something like 60 or 70% of the entire liabilities of the euro area with the core are liabilities with core banks. Then the crisis in two steps. Yeah, there was like first, there is the financial crisis. So, I mean, this we all know as shown in this graph that prior to the crisis, like core banks were investing massively in the US, were investing massively in the subprime market. So you can see from the graph from 2005 to the peak of this thing in 2007, I mean, there was an increase of, what's that? 50%, I mean, the 50% of GDP of resources that were sent from the core of Europe to the US markets, which is a big amount of money, right? So then there was the subprime crisis, there was like this world recession, and like banks in the core of Europe, they faced massive losses. I mean, just to give you an idea, like German banking system, 3% of their total assets were invested in subprime. So just to give you an idea of the amount of losses that they faced. Okay, so what was the reaction of core banks? So these two graphs are showing you, again, for this brief time span between 2007 and what I think is the end of the financial crisis per se, these are the foreign assets of the core banks. And as you can see, I mean, like going from 2020, where the line ends, there is already a reduction of something like 30% on total assets abroad. Yeah, on total. This is total overall. So there was like this massive balance sheet retrenchment by core banks. So, I mean, what was the strategy that we followed at the time? I mean, this was a global crisis. So, I mean, we set up this new G20. It was really nice. We committed to sustain activity through fiscal power. We committed to re-regulate the financial system. Then, at the euro area level, we did two things. On the one hand, we had like this centralized liquidity provision. So monetary policy was operating through the ECB. And as you can see here, from 2007-2008, I mean, ECB lowered the interest rates. There was like the main refinancing operation, long-term refinancing operations. They became full allotment so that banks could ask for as much liquidity as they wanted at the ongoing price, something very different from previously. And if you look, I mean, like the balance sheet multiplied by 2 just in 1 year. So there was all the support for core banks that were having like big, big problems. But then there was the bank resolution leg of this, and this was national. So this was each country that had to pay whatever bill they decided they had to pay for their banks. And this had a very big cost for them on impact. So if you see the first column here, these are like in percentage points of GDP from 2007-2009. What it meant in fiscal cost to bail out the financial system. So on the average for the core of Europe, this was 10% of GDP, as compared with the periphery, where at that point was 2.5%, so 4 times less. My point is going to be that this combination of monetary policy that goes at the aggregate or at the euro level and national resolution is what sowed the seeds for what we saw afterwards, that is the financial fragmentation of Europe. So, I mean, I think that we all kind of know pretty well the story, you know. There was like Greece, they were fiddling with the numbers, so the markets, they began to be very concerned about them. After them, there was like the other Europeans, even other countries in the advanced countries that had spent so much money, so their sustainability became a problem. Then finally, Greece was about to implode, so they asked for us, the IMF, for funding. The ECB began with this S&P program, started to buy sovereign bonds in the secondary market in an attempt to lower the spreads, because it seemed that the monetary transmission mechanism was breaking for Europe. Europe was breaking into pieces, the core and the periphery already then. Then on top of this, the G20 at that point decided that, I mean, like, fiscal profligacy had been enough, so we had to go into fiscal restraint, and this sort of accelerated everything. It was Ireland that went into stress. After Ireland, it was Portugal. The ECB went in with like these two special long-term refinancing operations, €1 trillion. And at the end, it was only the promise of these outright monetary transmission operations by the ECB last year that sort of calmed the thing. And at that point, we began to think how do we get out of this? How we break this perverse link between fiscal and financial problems, and how do we render the system more stable going forward? So the idea there was like all this banking union, no, and having like the European Stability Mechanism to recapitalize banks, so on. So, I mean, this tells us, or this is to show you the amount of money that core banks withdrew from the periphery. You know, from 2009, last quarter of 2009 is this third column here. Fourth quarter 2009 to the third quarter of 2012. I mean, they just like dumped almost, I mean, they brought out of the periphery almost 100% of the periphery's GDP in financing. And how we handled this? Again, as I just explained, there was a lot of centralized liquidity provision, and this is this last bit here. I mean, from 2010-2012, you see that the balance sheet of the ECB multiplies again by 2. And of course, there was like the national approach to bank resolution. And of course, what happened? You know that in the periphery, from having like 2.5 percentage points of GDP in like rescue costs On the average, this jumped to 22.3, and this is not including all the money that the IMF gave to Portugal for their banks, all the money that the IMF gave to Greece for their banks. This is not including the ESM money for Spain. So, and then what happened? Like, on the one hand, like all this liquidity provision, all these long-term refinancing operations, they simply made the fiscal financial interconnection at the national level even bigger. So they made this kind of like systemic problem even bigger. But in addition, I mean, like by having these national resolutions, not only the fiscal authorities, but the national central banks, they were loading up with a lot of liabilities that previously were public, were private. Yeah? So, I mean, it is this combination of things that sort of like has brought us to this twin crisis we are living now, where fiscal and financial stress are one thing that you cannot disentangle no more. No? So, I mean, what was the role of the euro system in all of this? Yeah? So, I mean, like, the framework of the euro system is such that whenever a German bank wants to withdraw or makes any kind of operation with a Spanish bank, there is no actual exchange of money. Everything is just get annotated in this system, euro system that is called target. Yeah? But this happens the same when, imagine that the bank in the eurozone loses some deposits. And instead of shrinking the balance sheet, or instead of going to the interbank market to get that liquidity, they want to get the liquidity from the ECB. So they just go to the ECB, they place there whatever the assets they have, and they get the liquidity. So it's pretty automatic. Yeah? So in this graph here, what I'm showing is like as a percentage of the total, what amount of liquidity from the central bank was going to the periphery, and what amount was going to the core. And it's kind of nice to see that until well into the crisis, it was not that the periphery was like getting more liquidity from the ECB. It was the core who was absorbing a lot of liquidity from the ECB. Yeah? What happened? The crisis came, and there was like, you see, from 2008 going forward, there is this repayment. So whatever was being like ECB liquidity for the core was becoming ECB liquidity for the periphery. Good. So, I mean, along all this, I mean, supposedly, this is helping us soften the blow. Yeah? So, well, I mean, adjustment. So, how much adjustment we are carrying on? I mean, if you look at the data, I mean, like, you see that there are productivity improvements. In Spain, productivity has increased a lot. Of course, I mean, there are 20% of the population that before was working, that they are not working now. So, probably the ones that are working are the ones that are more productive. So that's fine. There has been a big correction in the current account. There has been a massive drop in imports. Yeah, our salaries are being pulled down, so we are importing less. But then, I mean, if you look at balance sheet adjustment per se, this is going very slowly. If you see the amount of outstanding debt by different sectors, this is basically not moving. And I think that there are a few reasons for this. So this graph here is trying to show one. I mean, this graph is comparing the number of defaults as percentage of the total amount of credit for non-financial corporations, NFCs, and for households. It's comparing the US and Spain, and you can see the numbers, you know? So whenever there is a default, there is deleveraging because there is a nominal debt is disappearing. It's not that you are generating inflation to get rid of it. It's disappearing. This is the numerator just falling. Yeah? So debt to GDP, this is directly affecting the numerator because this is debt that is being cancelled. So, I mean, this should be one of the main ways to reduce the level of leverage in Europe, but we are, at least in Spain, we are using it very little. And then if you look at asset prices, I mean, on the left-hand side you have house prices, on the right-hand side you have the stock market indices. And I have put the index at the first quarter of 2010, which is when I argued that the beginning of the sovereign debt crisis is placed. I mean, you look at it, there is hardly any correction. But if you go and you look in past crises, past fiscal financial crisis, the level of corrections for these two types of assets should have been massive, but it's simply not there. I mean, this is the power of the ECB, or all this liquidity that the ECB is providing. I mean, it's allowing us to support these prices and avoid like these fire sales and massive falls in prices, which in a sense, it's good because you don't want like markets to overreact. But on the other hand, it's not good because, I mean, the smaller the corrections, the bigger the amount of public funds that we are going to need in order to get out of the problem. Yeah? And this is a point that is, this was made by Steve Chegget in a paper he just published in December. I mean, I discovered the paper by Steve Chegetti like last week, and it's very related to mine. I mean, he's looking at the things from a very different perspective. But it's really, I mean, it's really nice paper, to be much nicer than mine, indeed. So more on the euro system infrastructure. Yeah? So as I just said, this system seems to facilitate like these large changes in the composition of funding like in very short period. So what I have in that graph? That graph is again like telling us, no, like on the vertical axis we have the percentage of the liquidity provided to by the ECB that is going on the yellow one to the German banks, and on the red line to the sum of Italian and Spanish banks. And this is amazing, because I mean, I still didn't find anyone that can explain me this fact, so maybe someone here can help me. But what was the German banking system doing with 60% of the ECB liquidity for 5 years before the crisis? I mean, I haven't found a person that can explain me this. Fair enough, doesn't really matter. I mean, what to me is really shocking is that starting in the second quarter of 2008, this is the beginning of the financial crisis, if you see how these two series can move, the correlation is 0.82, right? And if you look at the period before, that's 0.04. So, I mean, this is a massive increase in correlations that, to me, speaks of replacement of on funding. So a bit more on that. Again, the Germany and the ECB. So this is going to be for the, I mean, this since 1999, so that we didn't have even the euro yet. Yeah? I mean, on financial transactions, we were using it, but the currency was still not there. In any case, I mean, you can see that all the way until 2011, German banks, they were demanding liquidity from the ECB, so they were levering up against the ECB. But all of a sudden, in a few months, they go from asking the ECB for loads of liquidity to become a drag of liquidity in the system, right? So, I mean, like, when I see this piece of evidence, and I see the previous piece of evidence, I mean, I can't say what's going on because we don't have information on what's the collateral of the ECB, so we cannot really say what kind of assets are being financed by the ECB. But to me, I mean, and if someone has a better explanation, you know, I'm really happy to hear. This to me, the appealing explanation for this is that these are the same assets, but the funding is just shifting. Yeah? And some assets that were funded by German banks before, Spanish assets funded by German banks, all of a sudden have to be Spanish assets funded by the ECB. Okay, so just 1 minute, excuse me guys. So I mean, we have this combination of national resolution, like this free cross-border banking with target to cushion the blow, and what this has led sovereigns to have to shoulder or to support like a pump financial systems. So this is a textbook externality. I'm not the only one to say this. There is a paper by the IMF and the Banking Union the same year. They are saying the same thing. Yeah, so, but then, I mean, the Banking Union, they want just to supervise the larger banks. And I mean, I completely agree that, I mean, if there is a Banking Union and they supervise large banks, I mean, the sovereign bank link is going to be broken because it's not going to be just one sovereign to support his banks. It's going to be the entire union to support those banks. Yeah, but there are two problems here. One is that the larger the safety net, the easier it's going to be for banks that they become even larger because they know that they can profit from this safer, larger safety net. So there might be a moral hazard issue going on there. But then, in addition, like they have that we have common resources, so it's all the European funds that are going to help bailing out the systemic institutions instead of just one country's bank is not going to eliminate the externality. And I mean, we know from economic theory that if we want to eliminate externality, well, we have to apply some kind of Pigouvian tax or a Pigouvian surcharge on the source of the externality, which are the source banks. And I know that this goes against the the capital moving freely around the European Union. But it's also true that this kind of surcharge fits pretty well on the ongoing discussion on too big to fail institutions. Thank you so much, and sorry for the extra time.